So hello and welcome to Yesterday Today, my sewing blog for the creations that I'm making that are inspired by the fashions of yesteryear and adapted for my modern day wardrobe. Now this week my project has been to do a Victorian-inspired blouse or shirt, and I thought as a great starting point I would go from this McCall's pattern, because I was particularly looking at this one down here with the slightly wide, almost but not quite, leg of mutton sleeves. If I show you the line drawing at the back, it's this one here. I really liked the shape of the sleeve, the pleating around the sleeve as well. I wanted a stand collar kind of like that. So I thought this would be a really good starting point. But there are some things about this that I wanted to change. I'm not keen about this yoke arrangement at the back, so I will certainly look to do something about that. And I'm thinking I could do a little something just to make the front of the blouse look a little bit more interesting. So what I did to get started is to trace out the front pieces, the front piece, the back yoke and the back piece, and think about how I might like to play with those. So let me show you what I came up with. Okay, so let's start at the front. This is the traced off front piece, just as it appeared in the pattern book, with the notches. Side dart, very simple, only very slightly shaped edge here. So what I did is I took out the seam allowance around the edges and traced it onto some paper. Now the first thing I wanted to do was to move the fullness from this underarm dart and move it to the shoulders, because I thought a series of tucks along the shoulder might be an interesting way of adding a bit of fullness. So all I did was cut a series of rays, and I thought if I do five tucks, odd numbers are always nice. So from not quite the bust point, I actually took it in a little bit because the bust point seemed too far over, I cut five slots from that, radiating from that point, and I closed then the dart and just spread out the fullness along here and evenly spaced it with 7mm little pleats to happen there. Then I thought, well, maybe either side of this band it might be nice to put in a few tucks as well, so I added a similar amount, about 7mm, 8mm, to make two extra tucks, and that was just slicing it and opening it. So that gave me my front piece, which I then of course traced out, adding in all the various features. So you can see I've drawn those in, the pleats at the top, I have drawn in those tucks along there, and of course then I added the seam allowance all around, made sure to keep in the grain line so I didn't lose that, made sure to keep all of the notches, balance marks happening. So that was the front. For the back, originally we had the yoke cut on the fold, and the back piece also cut on the fold with just this little pleat here. Now I wanted to add the two together, so again I cut these out of paper without the seam allowances this time and transferred it over. So not a lot that I did to this one. As you could see, I had a look how much extra fullness there was going to be in the pleat compared to what the yoke had, and I split that that extra fullness over three different little tucks. So I just split the yoke in three places at regular intervals and then fit that together. Because it was slightly curved, I just ignored the bit of curve in the seam to get it pretty much as close as possible, making sure that the sleeve was about the same size as the original one, so it would have lost just a bit of fullness through here in doing that. So all I did was insert some paper underneath that as I stretched it out, and then I could just transfer all of that onto my finished pattern piece, marking again those tucks about 7 or 8 millimeters, adding all of the dots and notches. I knew that being a bit taller than average, I was probably going to need a bit of extra space at the bottom, so I added a little bit more hem space rather than actually splitting it in the middle and bringing it down. I figured I'd just add it to the hemline and thought, okay, well, let's take it from there and see where it goes. Now, there are a few more changes that I will need to do to this pattern down a bit, but we'll see that as this shirt gets made. So here we go. The material I was using is this lovely lightweight linen, natural colour, but that will pick up the tucking beautifully, I think. So let's see how this shirt comes together. So after pinning and cutting out all of the pattern pieces, the first job was to pin all of those tucks. Now, I marked all of the tucks and things with little bits of tailor's tacking. It's the way that I was always taught to do it. And it just means that you've got a lovely thread mark to follow. There were a lot of tucks. And it did take me a little bit longer than I was expecting. But the good thing about linen is you can almost press the little tucks in place with your fingers and just use the heat of your fingers to iron a nice little line in there. And so that did actually save a bit of time without having to constantly go to the iron to iron down those little tucks. So once I had them all pinned, it was off to the machine and get it all sewn down. Again, not a difficult job, just time consuming, pulling out the little tailor's tacks as well, and then of course making sure to pull the threads through to the wrong side and not off the end of each of those tucks as well. I think all of that finishing off probably took a lot longer than the actual pinning and sewing of the tucks, more than anything else. But those sort of details are worth it, especially for finishing off the threads properly as you go along. So once I had all the tucks in, I then sewed on the band at the front, center front, so that's that the buttons will be attached to and the buttonholes as well. And that of course means a fair bit of hand sewing. There was more hand sewing in this than I was expecting, and yep, I will speed it up. I was just using a simple slip stitch here to sew the wrong side down towards the end. And actually I really enjoyed the hand sewing. So that is the completed front of the blouse with the band on there. You'll see that I've also stay stitched the neck, and that hand stitching finishes off quite neatly. And of course linen is beautiful to press, so those pleats are good. Right, so here's my shirt so far. As you can see, I've got the tucks in, I've put the front bands on, tucks are in at the back as well, and I've just sewn up the side seams and the shoulder seams. And I'm thinking about how best to finish off these seams, because as you can see, this fabric is a little bit sheer, so whatever I do will be slightly noticeable. Like, it's not completely sheer, but I'm thinking overlocking's not going to be the way to finish this off. Possibly if I'd thought about ahead of time, I could have done French seams. But one I do know that is often used on things like shirting, because it's a bit of a stronger seam, is a flat felt seam. And if I do it by hand with the second one, it should look quite neat and finished. So I might give that a go and see what I think. If I'm thinking the top stitching will actually look nice, I may yet do that. So for a flat felt, I'm going to do it towards the back. So I'll trim this half off the seam down to, you know, 6 mils. Probably not much more than that. Now, because this is linen, I probably won't even need to use an iron to do this pressing. But if I were now to fold this over once, and that will, let's just cut these threads here, that will contain the raw edges. Well, since I didn't manage to actually get any of this in the picture, what I'll do is I'll put a link below that explains exactly how flat felt seams work. Suffice to say that yes, it's a bit more fiddly than doing an overlocked edge, and even probably a bit more fiddly than doing a French seam. And because I decided to hand sew the felt seam down, yes, it does take a bit longer, but it ends up with a beautifully neat finish. And you can see it in this picture now, that you see just a little bit of that hand stitching coming through, but it complements it beautifully. So it's collar day. Never my favorite job when it comes to putting shirts together, but of course shirts need collars. So what I have here is the two layers of the shirt fabric, right sides together. This side has the interfacing laid on top. And here you can see I've just started to pin it already. What I'm going to try to do with this shirt, because I always struggle to get the shirt collar to sit properly, I'm going to try just shift the underlayer of the collar out a little bit, just to make it that bit smaller and hopefully help with the curve of the collar. So as you can see, I've only moved it out by a couple of mils on that side, and I'll do the same on this side, and then just slightly stretch that underlayer to see whether that actually helps with getting the collar to sit properly. This will be a stand collar, so there'll be this extra piece, the stand that will sit between this collar and the actual shirt. So let's see how that goes. So the collar came together fine. I didn't decide to do any top stitching on any of it, just to keep it simple and neat. You can see here I'm just pinning on the stand of the collar to the neckline of the shirt, and once that was done, of course, there's more hand stitching as I hand stitch the inside of the collar. And this time, yes, indeed, I get Laurie helping me to do my hand stitching. I think this is going to become a feature of various videos, having Laurie come and try to help me. And she's certainly intrigued by the pins as I was trying to sew. And yes, intrigued by the iPad as I was videoing as well. So the joys of sewing with a lorikeet, it takes about three times longer with a lorikeet, and she can be very sneaky at times in trying to get to said pins. She's certainly taking quite an interest in trying to make sure she didn't get the pins or my needle or tangled up in the thread. Is always fun. Well, Laurie seemed to enjoy it anyway. Hey.
Thank you.
Sneaky.
Yes, the joy of working with lorikeets.
Make this hard, you know that.
So once the collar was in, it was time for the sleeves. Now, I won't bore you with what I was talking about in this video, but I had done the pleats on the shoulder of the sleeve and just done the sewing up the inside of the sleeve. And I wanted to just get a feel for the fit of the sleeve because I was worried it was going to be a bit too loose in the forearm. So I did actually bring that in probably about 2 centimeters by the time it gets to the wrist and just make sure I had enough room there to be able to get my hand through without having to use a button. I finished off that sleeve seam with a felled hem again, hand stitched down, and then just put the sleeve in as per normal, and it went in beautifully. Very happy with the final result. So here's my shirt as it's looking at the moment. I'm really loving the shape of these sleeves, and I'll certainly like it even more as this as the linen sort of softens and wears a bit. It's still a little bit crisper than I wanted it to be. Now the only thing with this is that while I have added length to the original pattern, knowing that I'm a bit taller than the average, I'm not liking this length. I'll probably want to tuck it in, and if I do, there is not quite enough length to really hold it in the waistband. So what I'm thinking I'm going to do is design this a bit more as a shirt waist, and a shirt waist pretty much has a band around the waist and it can just sit there nicely. And I think if I were to do that, then that might work best in terms of tucking in. So what I've done, I've cut a band ready to put in here, and then I had to work out how did I want to bring this in at the waist. And what I think I will do is do a series of little pleats to sort of mirror the pleats that are happening here and at the back as well, and hopefully work properly. So what we will do, you can see I've marked these little pleats already. So I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to put these in and then add the band and pretty much just see how it goes. If I don't like it, well, I'll come up with another solution. Oh yay, more tucks. So I made myself a template to mark all of these tucks in place. And then it was just a matter of pinning and sewing exactly as I had for every other little tuck that I had done in this shirt. I have to say, by the end of it, I was getting a bit sick of doing the tucks. But again, these sort of details make a shirt like this. So it was lots of pinning, lots of sewing, lots of knotting threads. What you can see here now is preparing for the waistband. I chose to pull a thread to get a nice straight grain for this waistband in the fabric. So by pulling a thread, I was able to then follow a nice straight grain mark through the fabric to cut a nice straight rectangular piece. It takes a little bit of extra work, and probably in retrospect, I should have done this from the get-go with cutting all pieces just to make sure I was completely on grain. And probably in the future I'll use this a lot more. So once I had the straight grain, I measured my waistband. I did make this a little bit wider than I thought I was going to need because I wasn't completely sure how wide I was going to make my waistband. So I figured if I've got a bit of extra width there, I can just cut it off later on. Then it was just a matter of pinning that to the waistline and sewing it up, making sure and checking that all of the tucks are facing in the correct direction. in general, I wanted to have them radiating out from the center, was the way it was generally working. So it was keeping an eye on that. You'll see I've got a really wide seam here. I think it was about a 3 centimeter, as that was what I was trying for the waistband at this stage. Here I'm just finger ironing it down to save having to move over there to the iron, and then preparing to turn this band over to the wrong side in preparation for hand stitching. And as you'll see in just a moment, oops, I folded that little bit the wrong way. So I was back to the iron to fold that little bit down. After I'd hand stitched the waistband down, it was then a matter of doing all of the buttons and buttonholes. These buttons are just a group that I had in my little button jar over there that seemed to work really nicely. I had the right number of buttons for it, the right size, the right colour. So why not use what I've got in my stash? I just did my buttonholes on the machine. I'm not going for historical authenticity in my Victorian-inspired shirts or anything like that, so I'm more than happy to use the machine to do machine buttonholes, and certainly they do finish rather nicely. As you can see, I always like tucking the end of the threads into the shirt, just to really help finish it off nicely. It means you don't have little knots and little bits of thread sitting here, there and everywhere. So it finishes it beautifully. I chose, rather than putting a button on the waistband, to put hooks and eyes in, or hooks and bars instead. Sewn bars look so much neater in a project like this than using the eyes of a normal hook and eye. I don't know how well you can see what I'm doing here, but sewing a bar like this basically takes sewing a plain bar, so just taking 2 stitches through the length that you want this bar to be, and then almost doing a buttonhole type stitch. It's a simple knot that you create with your thread. Maybe someday I'll make a bit of a tutorial that can help teach people how to make these sorts of hooks and bars. Makes for quite a strong way for the hooks to hold into place, and certainly looks much less obvious and much neater than the metal eye that you get in your hook and eye. So for something like this, I know of no better way, and it gives this shirt then a much neater finish at the bottom there. Perhaps down the track I'll substitute these 2 hooks and eyes for one larger sort of skirt hook. But this is what I had in. These work. And as you can see, I'm just finishing it off as I always do by pulling the final thread through. Makes for quite a neat finish. And I think that looks much better than having a button there at the bottom to finish off the waistline. And that is the shirt complete.
Here you can see the completed shirt. So let me just take you through a few then of the adaptations that I made to this shirt. The collar is pretty much as it was intended, as is this beautiful pleating of the sleeve and the fullness of the sleeve. The only thing I adapted with the sleeve was that I brought it in at the forearm a little bit, as I wanted it just that little bit tighter. The initial pattern had the underarm bust out here. I moved that fullness up to the top here and used the tucks on either side to take up that fullness. And I also added the tucks on either side of the band there. With the shirt, I wanted it to be a bit more fitted around the waist. And because it wasn't long enough to tuck in, I ended up putting a waistband in like a Victorian shirtwaist, and I gathered in the fullness then with these extra tucks. Moving to the back, again you can see the extra tucks at the bottom. And then the other thing I did differently, rather than have the yoke back with just a little center pleat there, I put the yoke shirt all in one and
put the fullness in with extra little tucks at the back there to mirror what we've done at the front. So the fit otherwise for the shirt is pretty much the same. I didn't change the fit at all. It was mostly just moving where the fullness was and how that fullness was gathered up as well. So I am really happy with how this has turned out. Certainly like it with a scarf added to it as well. And hopefully it'll be a lovely addition to my wardrobe. Anyway, thank you for joining me on this little project, and I look forward to seeing you again in the future. Okay. Bye.